In 1990, a legend of Dallas wrestling attempted to recreate the glory days of World Class. Though they weren't able to recapture that lightning in a bottle, this promotion did find its own brief success and helped put a future megastar on the map. This is Defunct Championship Wrestling, Episode 13, Gary Hart's Texas Wrestling Federation. Now, unlike a lot of entries in this series, there's not really many retrospective articles chronicling the history of the TWF. Nothing from Ring the Damn Bell or Cage Side Seats, or any of my other go-to sources. But thankfully, that won't be a problem here, as Gary Hart discussed its founding and its fall in his book, My Life in Wrestling. So that will be our main source today. In late 1989, Gary Hart left the NWA. He had felt disrespected by Ric Flair after the Nature Boy took over booking for WCW. He had grown frustrated with the NWA booking committee and was sick of Turner Broadcasting's Jim Herd and corporate bureaucracy. To make a long story short, the final straw for Hart was when Herd and Turner requested that he reveal under oath that wrestling was a work to resolve a fan's lawsuit against him. Gary stuck to his principles and refused to expose the business. So he quit shortly after that year's Starrcade. Not long after, he moved his family from Atlanta back to Dallas. Gary was never concerned with what he would do next, since wrestling for him had always been a revolving door of opportunity. His wife, however, disagreed with his decision to up and quit such a secure gig. They began fighting constantly and eventually would divorce. Gary Hart was at one of the lowest points of his life. His marriage was over, he was out of the wrestling business for the first time since 1958, and he had no clear direction anymore. That's when he received a call from Matt Bourne. The future Doink was passing along a message from Rodney Cooper, the manager of the Metroplex Arena. The arena was financed by some commodity investors and money was flowing, so they were looking to expand their activities. To achieve that, Cooper needed a new events director for the venue. Based on Hart's experience and connections, I'd say he was a great choice. Gary accepted the position and set to booking events. The Metroplex hosted concerts, boxing, roller derby, and much to Gary's displeasure, some terrible wrestling. At the time, the Metroplex was home to some sporadic trainee shows from a local wrestling school. Hart was so disappointed by what passed for wrestling there that he canceled their bookings and decided to start his own promotion to run the arena. Just like that, the Texas Wrestling Federation was born. Gary Hart reached out to friends and Dallas mainstays alike to fill out his roster for their Sunday evening events. Iceman King Parsons, Al Perez, Matt Bourne, Abdullah the Butcher, Terry Gordy, Chris Adams, and his student, a young Steve Austin. Steve Austin in his rookie year. While still green as goose shit in the ring, his promo ability was apparent right from the start. It's not the promo style that would make him the biggest draw of all time 8 years later, but the charisma and confidence on the stick was already there.
A lot of aggression, a lot of emotions, and whether we wear the shirts, whether they're trying to show what we're made of or not, it doesn't matter. We do what we want to do, where we want to do it. If we want to come down here to Hooters and have a few beers, drink some chicken wings, well, that's what we're going to do, because no one tells us what to do.
What?
Hey, you bunch of shots.
Got him. Got him. Got him. That's a bust.
I skimmed Austin's book, and it doesn't appear he talked about his time in TWF. Closest we have is his opinion on Chris Adams. Austin certainly didn't hold Adams in high regard, feeling that he'd been taken advantage of as a trainee and wasn't properly trained or smartened up by Adams. And what's wrestling in Dallas without Yvonne Eric? Well, thanks to a dispute with the competition, Gary was able to bring in Kevin Von Erich. While Gary Hart was getting the TWF up and running at the Metroplex, things across town at the Sportatorium were taking a downturn for Jerry Jarrett and the USWA. Jarrett's expansion into the area was not going as well as he'd expected. At some point in the later half of 1990, Hart received a call from Kevin Von Erich. Kevin was on a deal with the USWA that was a result of Jarrett's purchase of World Class. But he needed Gary's help, and in return, Von Erich would work some shows for TWF. Kevin was owed money by the USWA and had been getting the runaround. Gary Hart says in his book that when he arrived at the Sportatorium, he joined Kevin, his attorney Gray Pearson, who later would go on to purchase Global, a Dallas area judge, and a city councilman named Al Lipscomb. Together, the five of them confronted Bill Dundee and Jeff Jarrett regarding the dispute. There's not a lot of details, but by the end of the night, Kevin Von Erich had his money. And Kevin lived up to his word and went to work for TWF. Having Kevin Von Erich on the roster really helped draw folks to the Metroplex. TWF also landed a TV spot on Channel 27, and according to Gary Hart's book, a syndication deal that aired the show throughout the Caribbean. Because Hart wanted to focus on producing the TV show and booking the shows, he decided not to put himself on air as a personality. He would make occasional appearances, but he wasn't a constant presence on the shows. In November 1990, TWF began airing their TV show, Texas Championship Wrestling, on Channel 27. The show featured a lot of aspects that made World Class so great. A hot building in Dallas, wrestler profiles, some great action in the ring, and even Bill Mercer on commentary. And Mercer makes the mission clear right from the start of the debut episode that they were putting class back into professional wrestling. Get it? Like world class? He also called the show Texas World Federation Championship Wrestling. It's a mouthful, but thankfully they correct it for later episodes to just Texas Championship Wrestling. And let's talk about the name for a second. So as I said, the name of the TV show was Texas Championship Wrestling. The name of the promotion was the Texas Wrestling Federation. Steve Austin is really the only wrestler I can remember calling the promotion by its name.
1, 2, 3, the Texas Wrestling Federation champions will rule supreme.
Yeah, but...
And I think Gary Hart might have said Texas Wrestling Federation once or twice. Everyone else, though, called it Texas Championship Wrestling. And clearly with the name on the intro, I think they were trying to make it seem familiar to the audience. Sounds like World Championship Wrestling. Sounds like the World Wrestling Federation. Obviously, no one was going to be duped by it, but it's just a strange choice. But the roster and commentator weren't the only thing brought back from World Class. The TWF TV was produced by Mickey Grant, who had also produced the World Class TV at its peak. By mid-1991, the Texas Wrestling Federation was really on a roll. They established their championships, the Texas Heavyweight title won by Kevin Von Erich and later Al Perez, and tag team champions in Rod Price, who I love, and Steve Austin, giving him his first championship. They also added to the roster, talents like the Angel of Death, Terrence Garvin, and the One Man Gang. TWF also tried new concepts, most notably the Thunderdome match. The match is featured on the March 30th, 1991 episode, and honestly, it's a complete cluster. It was a cage match that had 12 competitors. Armageddon, Hell in a Cell, eat your heart out. Rules were every man for himself, and if someone was eliminated, they were handcuffed to the cage. Last man standing was the winner. I don't really get the handcuffing portion. Someone would be eliminated, handcuffed, and then nothing happened. They just stood there handcuffed to the cage. Obviously, guys were still going to fight each other, which led to situations like an eliminated Terry Gordy having a fireball thrown in his face. It was a good way to advance his feud with Abdul the Butcher, but it didn't need this cage match for it to happen. The cage itself was a cross between War Games, CZW's Cage of Death, and that red TNA monstrosity. But it's probably closer to the NWA WCW Thunderdome and Chamber of Horrors cage. It's always great to think outside the box and try something that hasn't been done before, but that doesn't always work out. I love Gary Hart as a booker and his eye for talent and how he puts feuds together, but maybe gimmick matches aren't his thing.
And the first time ever, a pole battle royal where all the men will be blindfolded. And they have to climb to the top of the pole for $500. All men will be blindfolded. Pole Battle Royal.
Don't miss it.
Around June 1991, Gary Hart was approached by Joe Pedicino. Joe was starting up the Global Wrestling Federation, as we know from DCW Episode 7. He was hoping Gary and TWF would be interested in a working relationship. And as you can see here, Gary had some choice words for Pedicino. It was a no. Maybe Hart should have taken the offer, because by the end of 91, attendance began to decline as Global started gaining momentum. And worse yet, the commodities market took a downturn and the backers of the Metroplex lost the lease to the building, putting an end to the Texas Wrestling Federation. In 1992, many of the former TWF talents would find their way to Global. Chris Adams, Iceman King Parsons, Terry Gordy, and Rod Price all showed up. Eventually, even Gary Hart himself would come aboard after Gray Pearson took over from Pedicino. Gary started helping out backstage at Global and even had some involvement with a couple of angles. And this would be the last time he was involved consistently with a pro wrestling company. In the following years, Gary Hart would run sold shows for charities, schools, and athletic clubs in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. He retired at some point in the late 90s, early 2000s, appearing ringside for the last time for the original MLW in 2004. After that, Gary lived a quiet life outside of wrestling, with occasional appearances in shoot interviews, at conventions, and in both documentaries about the Von Erichs and World Class. If I had to suggest one documentary over the other, it would be Heroes of World Class. It's the one I own, and it's far more in-depth. In March 2008, Gary Hart passed away of a heart attack. He was 66 years old. The next year, in June of 2009, his autobiography, My Life in Wrestling, with a Little Help from My Friends, was released. It's currently out of print and is requesting a very pretty penny on Amazon. But there's prints of it online, and someone even turned it into an audiobook on YouTube. Though the Texas Wrestling Federation is just a small piece of Gary Hart's legacy, it's a really fun show to watch. Thankfully, Armstrong Alley here on YouTube has uploaded what seems to be its entire TV run, or at least the majority of it from November of 1990 into April 1991. If you like World Class, you'll enjoy most of it. Sure, the show has got its fair share of dull and bad matches, but overall, it's got good characters and the kind of Texas wrestling you know and love. In my opinion, it's a faithful extension of the World Class legacy. I enjoyed watching the majority of it, so I suggest checking it out. And that's it for the Texas Wrestling Federation. Be sure to share your thoughts on TWF in the comments. And let me know any other defunct promotions I should add to the list. We've got so many already, but the more the merrier. I'm Scott from WrestleSpective. Watch wrestling, love wrestling, thanks for watching.